Well, my name is Tom. I am at Pyramid Yoga Center right now in the jungle. I came back after my healing program took place in November. And I'm here for the teacher's training this time. Now is in March, so it's about 4 months apart.
What I want to share and who I want to inspire.
I would like to have this opportunity of sharing my experience with people out there that have the experience, not so great experience that I had. Hopefully I can be some kind of help for people that had cancer in this case. Hopefully I can inspire them. So I'll start with my story. I am a businessman. I work in New York in fashion business, which is it's a very stressful business. I was there for 8 years trying to make a label for ourselves. It was very stressful because my working hour is over 20, I think. Yeah, 20 hours a day, because I have to work both sides. I have to work Hong Kong hours and I have to work New York hours. So that actually lasted for 8 years, the lifestyle. So eventually I was diagnosed with cancer, gastric cancer, stomach, in September when I felt pain in my stomach. But then again, everybody had pain once, at least several times in their lifetime. So I didn't really pay attention to it. The pain dragged on for about a week. But I always thought I can just, I can work through this. So eventually I can't take it anymore, so I went to the emergency room in Brooklyn, where they did the everything. They did the CT scan, they did the CAT scan, they did the microscopy, they put a tube up down my stomach, and that's when they found out that I had a tumor of the size of my thumb. Consider it's pretty big, because a stomach is normally the size of our fist, or my fist, so it's pretty big. And it was actually right at the top of my stomach. That's where the tumor was. So they found that. They did a biopsy and tried to figure out what kind of, if it's a tumor, so they tried to figure out if it's a cancer. And they later found out, I did twice for that examination, and they found out later it's cancer. So basically, they want me to do is to cut it out, because modern Western medicine, or the doctors from the Western world, there's not much to do with the cancer. There's not much option. So, it's either the operation, then there's the chemo. So anyway, I was diagnosed in an emergency room. They kept me for 3 days, released me. Eventually, I went home directly right after they released me. I went back to Hong Kong. And I get another diagnosis from numbers of doctors in Hong Kong. And that's when the doctor suggested, or the surgeon suggested, that I should remove my stomach as a solution to my case, which was a relief actually, because from the day that I was diagnosed to the day that I came up with the solution, it took me 2 weeks to get to that solution, because nobody knew what to do with it. So basically that was a relief when they told me that I can, that's what they're going to do, they're going to remove my stomach. My parents was very shocking. You know, they were all with me in Hong Kong, my families and friends, and they all were there. So I was scheduled to have my stomach relieved. So I was actually on the operation table, pushed into the operation room. Before they operate, they need to do another test or another exam to make sure that there's no spread from my stomach. Because if there's a spread, there's no point of removing my stomach. And the funny part is that the doctor says because the tumor was at the top of the stomach where it connects the throat and goes down to the digestive system, they were actually saying that if it is really difficult for them to keep any stomach, which means they will have to cut out everything and then connect the throat to my intestine. But they said that if they could, save me some stomach. Actually, they said the stomach will grow a little bit if there's, you know, and then serve the purpose of the stomach, even if it's being removed. And so anyway, so I was pushed in. So they did this examination where they put three camera or probe into my stomach. And that's when they found out that I had a spread in my peritoneum area, which is like the wrap between the organ and the layer of my skin. There's in between there's like a plastic wrap that protects the organ. So all the cancer cells spread onto that wrap, which means they can no longer operate. They cannot cut out the stomach because it's been spread. So I was in the operation room for 30 minutes. I'd gone through all this anesthesia and the drugs and everything, and they had to push me back out. That's when the doctor came in, talked to me, and my parents were all there, my friends. They were all there, my girlfriends. The doctor says that they can't do the operation because it spread. Now, because it spread, it turns me into a automatic gastric cancer stage 4. That's like the last stage. He tried to comfort me. You know, he said, "Oh, it's not my fault." it's often that, you know, when this type of cancer is realized, is always at the later stage. There's no way that I could have known or I could have prevented. So he actually tried to make me feel good. So just make it sound like that's not my fault. So at the point in time, I had the micro surgery. I was in pain. So I was laying on the bed. My parents were surrounding me. The doctor came in and says that because it's stage 4 gastric cancer, my survival chance, if I don't do anything, if I go home and don't do anything, I will probably have 3 months left. And if I do everything, if I do everything the doctor says, including operation or chemo, whatever it is, I will probably be looking at 16 months. So basically, they're telling me that it's over. And then, of course, we want to know right away that, you know, what's the chance of healing. So we asked the doctor, you know, what's the chance of getting cured? And the answer was actually stunning, because he told us that, well, he told me that my chance of living is 2%. So there's a 22% of chance of me survival. That means there's 98% of chance that I will die. So all, you know, my parents were crashing out, you know, and all crying, and everybody was like, "Oh my God!" So that was the end of it. And then, because I cannot remove my organ, my stomach, they suggested I should be on chemo, and they cut my tissue so they can send in for more lab tests to see if I am eligible for targeted medicine, which the type of cancer gastric cancers nowadays can be treated as a, for the target medicine. And so according to the doctor, there's only 10% of chance of me I'll be eligible, because not everybody responded to target, not everybody's cancer cell responded to the target medicine or the target drug. So he sent in for the test and he says, oh, he will know about that in 2 days. So later we found out that I was eligible, because my cancer cell actually reacted to the drug. So according to him, I was the lucky one, and you know, my cancer cell can actually be treated by the target medicine. Anyway, so they decided to put me on chemo. So the original plan was to have 6 chemo shots, and then along with that, 6 target shots. So that was the plan. So now we're going to talk about the process I was in when I was doing chemo. It wasn't a very it wasn't a pleasure experience. It was very traumatizing, actually. It's very stressing. So anyway, the doctor put me on 6 chemo shots, and I had my first chemo shots. But when you, well, we heard about this, you know, when you're on chemo shots, you know, you're not gonna feel good. So the first shot actually knocked me out for 5 days. So I was actually in the bed, can't do anything for 5 days. And during the time, I cannot eat, I cannot move, I'm like a patient. Which made me uncomfortable, because before the chemo shot, although I was diagnosed with cancer, but I was I have my mobility, I can move around, I can still walk, I'm fine, I feel fine. But the chemo actually knocks you out. So the chemo and the target knocks me out. While I cannot move and I cannot eat, the doctor still put me on a booster shots that I need to go and take every other day for 5 days, for 5 times. So every other day I need to go get a booster shot to keep my white blood cell at a level where it cannot drop. If my white blood cell drop, I will not be able to do the next chemo shot, because my immune system will just not there. So they need me to do that. So while I was unable to move and everything, I have to go out, struggle, you know. My friends, you know, help me, move me around, carry me to these clinics. You know, I have to do the shots. That was the first shot of chemo, and 3 weeks later I had my second chemo shot, which after the first one I thought, okay, 5 days, you know, I can live with 5 days, not 2 days, it's okay. But the second one was the most difficult one, because it actually put me in bed for about 10 days, and I can't move, everything, I still remember, and everything smelled bad. Everything, you know, even perfume that's supposed to smell good, it smells bad. I need to be in an environment that's odor-free, no smell, which is impossible, because I live in Hong Kong. It's like a matchbox, you know? And so I can actually smell people next door when they were cooking. So it's very difficult for me, and it makes me want to throw up all the time. You know, it doesn't matter what it is. A little bit of smell. And of course we asked the doctor, you know, why. And the doctor says, well, everybody's react differently to chemo. So he never encountered this kind of reaction, but he said, well, it should be normal. So for 10 days, every day, I was in bed, you know, trying to get myself up. Then during all this time, during the chemo sessions, I was accompanied by my mom. My mom was actually taking care of me during that time, which made me, I mean, I am very grateful that she was there, you know, be supportive. My girlfriend was always there, supportive. But the fact is that, you know, sometimes all this caring becomes pressure. It becomes stress. It's not that they all meant good. Okay, my mom meant good. You know, every day she would try, because the number one thing that doctor said is that after you're on chemo or end target, the number one goal is not to lose weight. You have to do whatever you can to maintain your weight, which is difficult because you cannot eat. So, and of course there's other supplements, you know, they made special, like a protein shake, specially designed for cancer patients. So I took those. Not exactly the best shake that you would take. And every day my mom will ask me, what do you want to eat today? You know, because she knows, she understands that I can't eat everything. So I have to visualize, you know, what I can eat today. What do I want to eat today? Even if I had that visualization, I still might not be able to eat it. But there are times, there are days. I just simply don't want to get up because I don't want to answer that question. Because my mom asks me the same question every day. And it becomes a pressure. It becomes a stress. You know, there are days I just don't want to wake up. Like I will be like, I'm up, but I just kept my eyes closed for about an hour or something, just to delay my wake. It is difficult for my mom as well. I have to say. I mean, she, because everybody panicked, you know, in the family. Everybody was, my dad, they don't know what to do with this kind of situation. And especially when you're on chemo, there are days that I don't know what's wrong with me, but I'm just like, I can't sit, I cannot walk, I don't know, you know, I'll be sitting here for 5 minutes and I have to get up, walk around for 5 minutes and then I have to lie down, and then it just, I don't know, something's wrong, but I cannot explain to you what is wrong with me. So my mom was like witnessing all this during the entire process. Of course, it is difficult for her, I think, I believe. And then she will, you know, she will try to help me, but she can't. And then there's even more stress coming out. I mean, she meant good, but it's just that, you know, she wanted to help. And then at that moment, or at that stage, all I want to do is just be left alone. But you cannot say that. It's just because they're good men. They want to help. So it wasn't a very pleasant moment. We had a couple fights. You know. It's not ideal, to say the least.
And how did you find out about Pyramid, and how was the process of coming in?
Okay, so after two chemo shots, and 60 days with my mom in Hong Kong, it's a matchbox. It's very stressful, and because they worry too much, you know, sometimes I'll be out with my friends. There are days that I am okay. I can walk. I just have my immune system a little bit, you know, below the level, but you know, I'm weak, but I can still manage. So I'll be out with my friends, and my mom will probably call me at 8:30 and ask me where you are. Are you coming back home? 8:30. So, with all the stress going through, my cousin, actually, my cousin that lived in Malaysia, Penang, that she told me that her yoga teacher knows a teacher is friend with another teacher that is actually the student of David's dad, and Sarah, I believe her name was, is, and she told my cousin that she should reach out to David, because David do some kind of cancer remission, and I may want to try. So my cousin shared that information with me. The moment I found out about it, I go, great. You know, it's like, well, I can go on a holiday. Take a break from my mom. So I was actually pumped to be away You know, there was finally an excuse, because you know, when you're sick, you become a 5-year-old again. You know, it's just you're not in any position to make any kind of decision at all when you're sick. When my cousin told me about Pyramid, I go, wow, okay, I can finally get a break. So I told my mom about this program, and my mom was like, oh, okay, great, I can go with you. No, no. Well, I didn't want that. But going back to the reality was that finding out about Pyramid, it was to help the situation. But people, my cousin actually wanted to help me to cure my cancer. But from my perspective, was that it was a vacation. It was a pure breakaway from all this pressure, all this suffocations, you know, with my mom. Not that I'm not grateful, don't get me wrong, you know, they all meant good. It's just that sometimes you just need to take a break from all this caring and all this trying to help you, you know, tension. You know, it's just too much tension going on. So anyway, eventually, I finally convinced my mom not to join me in Pyramid, and I flew from Hong Kong to Koh Samui, and then I get to Pyramid on the ferry, and then I got to the center, which was like a paradise to me, you know, because at the process of it wasn't any hesitation, it wasn't any doubt about. Should I go or should I not go? It was like, I am going. Okay, I want to go. Let me go. That kind of, it's not, there's no second guessing or second thoughts. But at the same time, it was also not about healing, not about curing. It's none of that. I wasn't even thinking of that. It's just that, wow, how bad can it be? You know, it's sun, beach, jungle, air. Yeah, it's just a vacation. So that was very simple. You know, my decision of coming to Pyramid was very, very simple. Of course, you have relatives. My cousin was very, again, very caring and worried that I cannot manage because, I was on my third chemo. So I was weak before I came to Pyramid. So I had a chemo shot. So I was kind of weak. Trying to recover from the chemo shots. So my cousin sent her husband to accompany me to Pyramid, which I'm grateful to, because he flew all the way from Phuket just to help me for a day, settle me in, which was nice. So that's how I got here, to Pyramid. I got to Pyramid, so it was like a breakaway from my family. And I treated it like a holiday. Didn't expect much or didn't think too much about what's going to happen. I came to this realization afterwards when I had another talk with my classmate doing the teacher's training recently. That the reason she asked me this question. She asked me why were you so calm? You know, when you arrive at Pyramid, and now I think back, is probably, you know, it's probably because I was trying to get away from the pressure, and I did it. So I was actually enjoying the freedom that I was exposed to, versus where I was worried or I was. Trying to get myself cured, you know, none of that was actually in my head at that period in time. But I just came to that realization afterwards. You know, at that stage in time, when I was doing the healing or cancer remission program, I wasn't thinking of any of that. I was just trying to enjoy the moment of me being alone. You know, it just felt great. So. But Pyramid, apparently, Pyramid Yoga, it's where I was, I am at. And I had no experience in yoga before I came to Pyramid. I had zero background in yoga. I don't know anything about yoga. So I met David. David was my healer. So he treated me. Well, the first day I got here, he taught me how to breathe. It turns out that I don't know how to breathe. It turns out the breathing method we were using, we are using, everybody's using nowadays, can be done so much better. I won't say incorrectly, but it can be done so much better. So I learned the three-part breathing technique the first day. It took me 7 days to actually understand what exactly is David talking about wave, the air, and breathing in. Again, like I said, I wasn't exactly flexible, so I never done yoga. So there's a lot of poses I cannot do. I can, you know, like stretching as a four bend, there's a lot of poses I just can't do. But David told me that it's really irrelevant about, you know, of course you want to get to, you know, as far as you can, you know, pushing your limits. But it's really not about the postures, not really about the postures, it's really more about breathing into the postures, which I find it very helpful for me. So doing that time I was here, I do morning class yoga, and we have sound session where David will put me on a sound bed and then vibrate me with using sounds. And of course there are, you know, chakras and all that stuff, which we don't have to go into detail. But then again, everything was new to me. Everything was so fresh. I never encountered, never experienced anything like this. So I kind of took in, I let myself empty, and I took in whatever was given to me. So, you know, there was the open session, there was the yoga, there was the healing, there was the chanting, there was all different types of things that I did during the 21-day remission program. It's very interesting. The diet is even more interesting. In the Asian culture, I'm from the Chinese background. In our culture, there's no such thing as detoxation. We will tell, if you're sick in Chinese culture, you will be told to eat light. When eat light means you eat congee, you know, light. Nothing too oily, no meat, you know, that kind of stuff. But you still eat rice, which is not a good idea because white rice contains a lot of sugar. It boosts up your blood pressure or blood sugar when you have a lot of rice. Anyway, so when I got here, while doing all that, and I still remember the very first day that I got here, it was that morning. I mean, yeah, that morning that I met Eli, and the first thing he asked me was, "Can you order coffee?" And I haven't had coffee for the past 3 months since I was diagnosed, and I got here in November. Yeah, about 2 to 3 months, I haven't had any coffee because my mom won't allow me. There's a lot of things that my mom won't allow me to eat. I mean, shrimp, seafood, because in Chinese culture, it actually, it bursts into something, I don't know, it's just weird. And I cannot eat a lot of red meat, of course. There's a lot of things I cannot eat. So the first day I got here, the first morning I woke up, and Eli asked me, "I want a coffee." I go, "Whoa, I can drink coffee." Yeah, as long as you without, don't do it with sugar, I can drink coffee. So I go, "Okay, sure, I don't mind. I would definitely like that coffee." So I had my first coffee in a long time, which tastes pretty good, and I felt it that while doing all this program, all these things that we, you know, the yoga, the breathing, everything, it's that never once I felt I was treated like a patient, where I was constantly reminded as a patient when I was back home, because mom will always be mom. And like I said, I'm a 5-year-old. So basically, all the caring becomes. I mean, I tell you this, you know, I feel fine. You know, before the chemo, I was fine. I can walk, I can do things. It's the only time that chemo, it's only when chemo was injected into my body when I feel sick. So it really creates some kind of question mark in my head. Is the chemo really helping me or is it killing me? Why am I even sicker when I'm on chemo? Well, of course, and then everybody knows chemo kills everything. You know, kills the bad cell, the cancer cell, it kills all the good cells as well. And that's why you're weak. But then, again, when you are in the environment of parenting, under my parents' care, you're reminded to be a patient, which I hate to be reminded as a patient. And then David took me to a restaurant, I think it was like the fourth day or something, fifth day, just to have a relaxation time, some break. So I went to the restaurant and again I was although I'm away from my mom, but my mom is still in the back of my head. So you know, there's a lot of things I look in the menu and I say to David, I can't eat any of that. And then David said, why not? I said, wow, I can eat anything? And David says, yeah. As long as we're not abusing it, you know. And for a long while, I had my first shrimp that day. It felt pretty good. And that's another thing about what David taught me in believing is that, you know, when something you do, it makes you happy, why are you not doing it? Why are you doing things that's making you not happy? Or you're not happy, it's not healthy. That works out for you. Pretty fun, pretty cool. So that's that. So going back to the brown rice, which is something that I've never done, which is interesting. The goal was to do it for 5 days. And then we pushed to 7. So eventually I did that total of 7 days brown rice, 3 meals a day, no salt, no nothing, just brown rice and water. It was an interesting experience. It was pretty easy actually for me to have that experience, which I can later tell you that I did the 10-day teacher training course. When I tried the 10-day, it was a little bit difficult, but we can talk about that some other time.
What is the goal with a rice diet? And afterwards, let's move about what really consists the healing program and how to change the belief system.
So the purpose of the rice diet, the brown rice diet, is to simplify your digestive system. You should only, because my stomach apparently, my stomach was overly worked. So it is very exhausted. So if we simplify our diet and just give them one thing to digest, and that will help detox and get rid of all this toxic in your body, which will help. And of course, with the breathing technique that I just said, it will also help you put more oxygen into your body. That will help you push out all the toxic away. You know? So I think it is important that it goes hand in hand. You cannot just say that, okay, I was cured from cancer because I did breathing alone or I did brown rice diet. It all works together. And of course the magical thing is the mind. It's the most important thing that you need to take into consideration, because human mind is powerful. And then I came to this realization after I talked to people about my situation, about my experience, and I came to this realization is that when I was in the 21 days, David often asked me if I have any thoughts. You know, I was doing Ekadasi, which is an 11-day breathing technique that I have to do. There are other things that we try, and they're, you know, meditations. You know, a lot of times David will ask me, do you have any thoughts? And the funny part about that is that during that 21 days, I had no thoughts. I was so calm and peaceful. I don't know why at that point in time. You know, never once I thought about curing myself. Again, never once I was saying, okay, I will win this. I will overcome this. This is not the problem. You know, it's the positive and all this affirmation that you will do to yourself when you're sick or you're trying to overcome something. And a lot of people do. But I wasn't doing any of that. So eventually I realized is that when I was diagnosed with cancer, I did not believe that I was sick. I wasn't in denial. I wasn't in denial about, no. It's just that I don't feel sick. And I was telling you that I can move around before chemo. I can still walk, I can talk to people, I'm fine. I feel fine. But the chemo dragged me down. And I came here when everybody treated me like a normal person. Like I am a perfectly fine person. I feel fine too. So, and of course David showed me a lot of documentary about placebo effects, about how mind works, quantum physics, energy. And with that in mind, I came to the realization that because when you believe in something so much, you don't need to constantly remind yourself that you believe it. It's just, my analogy is if you're a man or a woman, you don't need to be reminded, you don't need to remind yourself you're a man or a woman because you know you're a man or a woman. So in that sense, I believe I was fine. I believe it's so strong, I don't need to remind myself or have those affirmations to tell myself or hypnotize myself that I'm fine because I feel fine. I was fine. I am fine. So that was the realization, which I found very, very interesting that I like to share. It's fascinating how beliefs empowers, how your mind can empower your belief system. Mind can do wonders. I mean, we can heal ourselves. We have the capability. We have the immune system. According, David taught me a lot of, again, the documentary and all the, there's a lot of papers, and a lot of records that shows that we do, our body can do wonders. As long as we put our mind to it, it can happen. To reiterate my point of the mind, the power of believing, is that when you understand that what your body is doing to you, like David told me that, of course, a lot of cancer nowadays, a lot of people have cancer. More than ever, there's more cancer patients around the world. But a lot of times, cancer are caused by stress and anxieties. But I feel, because David told me that when a doctor told me that I have cancer, it's like end of the world. I believe a lot of people would feel the same way because, oh my God, I have cancer. But from David's perspective, which I find it very helpful, is that cancer, which is your body telling you that you need to pay attention to me. Your body is screaming for your attention. It's just like in my case. I had a stomach pain. Everybody has stomach pain sometime in their lives. Many times, probably. But we ignore it. We don't even look at it because it's so common. But until the point there where you can't stand it anymore, and then the stomach says, okay, enough. And there's cancer. It's just your body trying to get your attention, and as long as you have the attention, you're treating it. Your willingness to change. I was in a very, like I said, I was in a very stressful environment, industry. I smoked 2 pack a day. My working hours is extremely long. So there's a lot of things that I need to change, along with the belief system, that shifting. So during that 21 days, I had, it flew by like very quickly. And my, my girlfriend came and visited in the last week of my program, where I had to educate. Well, that's a strong word, education. I have to tell her what I need before she comes to Kapanai or come to Pyramid, is that I need to be treated as a normal person. I told her, literally, I told her an exact word was that if you come and you treat me like a patient, you know, you still, and I warned her about, you know, things I can, I'll be doing, like I'd be drinking beer, you know, things like that, which I was not allowed to do. So I warned her that you might see something that you don't feel comfortable because you believe that I was a patient. And I asked her not to react to any of that, you know, try to hide that emotion, hide that. Don't do it in front of me. I tried to educate her that, to tell her I need to be treated as a normal person. Then she agreed, so she came, and I was doing all the things that I was doing. She treated me like a normal person, which made me comfortable. And I think for all the patients or cancer patients out there, I think the number one thing is to not, well, first you need to make the change. Okay, you need to change your lifestyle, you need to change your mindset, you need to change whatever that you were doing, stop, make the change. And number two thing is that you have to treat it, like, hopefully your family or your friends will treat you not as a patient. I know it's difficult, but at least what you can do is that you don't treat yourself as a patient. You have to believe that you're not a patient. I think that I can only, that will help. So going back to my girlfriend came and we had, I mean, the week went by pretty fast, and then I was doing yoga every day. It was pretty intense, and I loved it. I think for the first week I was here, well, I was pretty weak. I can't really do anything. Even walking up and down the hill is making me exhausted. But by the time I hit third week, I was pretty pumped every time I finished the morning session, which I never thought I would be. So then I went back. Of course, I feel fine. Tino, David's assistant healer, she's more like a consultant than she talks to me. Yeah. And at a point in time, I think it was very helpful for me as well. I think it doesn't matter if it's true or it's not true. It's not none of that. It's like I told you, like I was saying, it's all in your mind. So when Atinu told me that she had this ability, she's a very sensitive, energy sensitive, so she can sense some sort of energy. So she put this thought into my head that she can't feel any cancer cell in my body. Regardless of the reality of that statement, you know, or you know, the truth about it, it doesn't matter. It's the fact that if that thought, the power of that thought could actually make you feel that you are cured. So I believe by the third week, like I was telling you, I was drinking beer because I believe I was fine. I believe I am okay. Although David still comes in and asks me, do you have any thoughts? Do you see any colors? You know, check our yoga. We see colors. We do meditation, supposedly. But I don't see anything. But I do feel an energy flow in my stomach, actually. It was a very interesting experience. I don't experience it too much. But it was like a couple times. It's like a current that flows in my stomach. It was like, boom. And it's like a heat. It feels pretty good. I won't give you the analogy. Because I felt like if you're ever in the pool and you pee, that's how you feel. The current, the heat. So I left Pyramid feeling fine, feeling I'm cured. Of course, my parents want me to go check up. It was time for checkup. So I went in and did the the thing. Then they put a tubing down my throat and into my stomach. And I have to admit, I was kind of nervous when I went into the when I got pushed into the checkup room. I was kind of nervous because I don't know what they're gonna find. Although I believe that I am cured, I'm still afraid that there are things that they're gonna find that I do not want to know about. So I was kind of afraid or nervous. So I used the technique that David taught me, you know, breathing technique. So I calmed him down. So they pushed me into the thing and then did the test, the lab examination. And after the examination, I felt my stomach was really painful. So I asked the nurse, the doctor left. So I asked the nurse, is that normal? Like, why am I feeling all this pain in my stomach? And then keep in mind, I haven't felt any pain after I left the emergency room in September. I don't know what happened, but I never felt pain. And it was so much in pain. And then later I found out, it was very interesting, because nowadays they give you a CD-ROM to show you exactly what the doctor did in your stomach. So I played the CD, and you can actually see the doctor was poking around my stomach, trying to grab tissues, because they can't find anything. First of all, the tumor of the size of my thumb disappeared, all the cancer cells disappear around my stomach, and because they're doctors, they want to be very careful, so they start grabbing tissues all around my stomach. Normally they probably do one section, you know, once in every section, so it's probably about a 5-minute procedure. My procedure was 30 minutes. So they would grab, so my, if you see the CD-ROM on the monitor, you will see that my stomach was bleeding all at the time. And that's why I feel pain in my stomach. And of course they didn't tell me that. The reason of being doing that is because the biopsy, they need to take tissues and they want to make sure there's no cancer cell. And eventually the test result came out and there's no cancer cell. So they can't find anything. Unfortunately, the doctors are not allowed to say that I was cured. It's very unfortunate because that's how the doctors are. And because to them, in their perspective, the reason why I have no more tumor or no more cancer cell is because the chemo worked, or the target worked. So they want to put me on more targets and chemo. So my doctor actually told me, okay, great, amazing, this is good. So the chemo worked. I'm going to put you on 3 more shots of chemo and target, just to be precaution, because you're young, you'll recover. I go, what? It's kind of ridiculous when you're actually hearing all that. I mean, you can't find anything, so what are you doing? Precaution reason, and I'm young, so I can be shot again and again and again. It just doesn't make sense, you know. And I asked the doctor, you know, what are you, there's nothing to kill. But then of course the doctor says, we don't know, they could come back. Which is pretty, that's what the doctor do, they try to scare you. But I want to remind you, I want to remind people, you know, doctors don't know any more than you do when it comes to cancer. I mean, I respect them, they spend years in medical school. They study everything about diseases, they know everything about diseases. They have all the solutions to diseases, like if you have flu, take this. Arthritis, take this. Diabetes, take this. They have medicines for all kinds of diseases they have studied. They don't have anything for cancer. That's the one part that they are very weak at. They're weak. They don't know any more than you do. So, then I came to this realization afterwards again. They're telling you how you are based on the report. Examination, lab test. But you can do exercise and you can do yoga and you can examine yourself how you feel. And if we're all guessing, you know, I came to this realization, is that if we're all guessing, if the doctor is guessing based on the reports and you're guessing based on the your body, your feeling. Why should we trust the doctor but not yourself? That's where I decided to trust myself. Because, you know, the more I see the doctor, they're just gonna threaten you more. Because remember, if you recall earlier, I said there was the cancer spread to my peritoneum. Peritoneum area, the wrap area, which until today I don't know. Doctors don't know, unless they penetrate me again to see inside. But I feel fine, so we're all guessing. So I decided to trust myself rather than the doctor. So when they wanted to put me on 3 more chemo, I ran away. I stopped going back to the doctor. I have to run away. But we're still doing breathing, we're still doing yoga, we're still doing exercise, the diet, you know, try to keep the meat level down. Everything helped, you know, the change helped.